Okay, so good morning all. So today we are going to discuss about your scheduling part. That's the second part of your second unit and the most important part, whereas coming to execution purpose. Now, before, in the previous class, we discussed about some of the properties or the features which we people are going to use in our scenarios. Okay, so that is nothing but your scheduling criteria. So we have seen some different kind of scheduling criteria using which we people actually gone through some proper features. And these are the features what we will be using in our solving the problems. Means what are the algorithms we are going to use and that we are going to execute it. So basically, in today's session, we'll be discussing about scheduling algorithms. So we have around 6 different types of scheduling algorithms what we have. But among them, only the first 4, what you people are seeing here, something called FCFS, SJF, priority, round robin. So all these 4 we will be executing here. Okay. So remaining two, this just will have a brief understanding of how this works, but we will not be doing any kind of problematic part within this. Later we have something called as algorithm evaluation. So what are the algorithms we have discussed here? We will be evaluating which is better, in which scenario we can use that particular algorithm, that we are going to discuss it. But basically right in today's session, we'll try to cover the first 2 what we have here, FCFS and SJF. So these 2 are the one which we will try to cover in this particular scenario. So coming to this, these are the one which we have already, we know that FCFS, shortest job, priority, round robin, multi-level and this. So coming to the very basic one, the first one what we have is first come first serve scheduling algorithm. The name itself, it is saying that whichever the process is coming first, that process will be executing first. Okay, that is what comes under in this particular this. So whichever process is actually, we do have a ready queue, right? Now within the ready queue, whichever process comes first, maybe suppose, let us suppose process P7 came first. So process P7 will be added at the head of that. This is your head and this is your tail. So head of that particular queue, ready queue, the process will be assigned. Now after that, process P1 arrives. So P1 will be allocated into the second slot. Okay, so this is the way it will be actually working. The first come first. So whenever the CPU is in an idle state, the CPU scheduler, what we discussed, the CPU scheduler what we have, it will take this process and allocate to that particular CPU. Until and unless this process is executing, the remaining processes have to wait. Okay. So when it is executing, if this particular process is requesting for some iBio device, it will be entering into a iBio queue. This is your iBio queue. Maybe like printer. Okay. So it is trying to print. So this P7 will come here. So this slot becomes empty. P1 will be shifted to the first one. It is nothing but push and pop. So whatever the next process we have, something like P3, that will come into this particular position and so on. This is the way this actual process works. So the basic thing what we have to understand here is the whichever the process is coming first, that process will be allocated to that particular CPU and it will execute. Since we discussed that this particular algorithm is of 2 types, primitive and non-primitive. If you remember in the previous session, we discussed about primitive and non-primitive. So what do you mean by primitive here is nothing but the external sources can try to interrupt the CPU when it is executing. Suppose as I told you that P7 is allocated to CPU, isn't it? So we have allocated process 7 to CPU. Now if another process comes which is of high priority or has more important, then automatically what will happen is this particular CPU, whatever the process is executed in the CPU, that will be removed and whichever the process next came, that will be assigned to it. This is a high priority process or something like that. So what we are doing, already some work the CPU is doing, but we are interrupting him and we are just trying to remove whatever he is doing and allocating another process to complete the task. That is what comes under primitive. Non-primitive in the sense, once the process is allocated to the CPU, until and unless this process is leaving the CPU, no other process can try to interrupt it. That is what we comes under non-primitive. For example, P7 is assigned to CPU. Now high priority process came P1. Even though he is high priority, since we are using non-primitive here, so this particular CPU will not be allocated to this high priority. He has to wait. Why? Because it depends upon this particular process P7 when he is removing this particular CPU. When he removes it, then only this particular P1 can be assigned to the CPU, the basic thing. So here your FCFS scheduling algorithm comes under something called as non-primitive. So non-primitive means once the process is allocated to the CPU, it depends upon the process. Until and unless the process is leaving the CPU on its own, no other process can try to access it. That is what comes under FCS. Okay. So basically, since we are talking about queue here, so we will be discussing, we will be using something called as FIFO queue. So within the FIFO queue, we will be adding the values, means the processes from at the tail. Okay, we'll be adding the process at the tail, and from the head, the processes will be allocated to the CPU. Okay, so the running process will be removed. So obviously, if one process is allocated to CPU, that will be removed from this particular queue, and the next process will be assigned to the, okay, it will be, means what are the processes are there that will be pushed one after another. Now, what is the best advantage of this particular thing is it is simplest among all. It's very easy. Whoever comes first, he will be served first. And whoever is coming late, he will be definitely served late. That's it. But what about the disadvantage here we have is the waiting time. The average waiting time for that particular algorithm will be very long. Why? Let us suppose we have two different processors, P1 and P2. Now, P1 is saying he requires around 5 minutes to complete the task. Okay? And P2 is saying he requires only 2 minutes to complete the task. But since P1 came first, what we are doing, we are allocating CPU to P1. So how much time that particular P2 has to wait in order to complete its task? 10 milliseconds. Why? 5 milliseconds he has to wait and 2 milliseconds to complete the task. So the total time it requires is 10 milliseconds to complete it. Okay. So what happened here? A long process came earlier. He is being serving first. Even though he is requires a less amount of time, he has to wait unless this P1 is leaving the CPU. That is the only disadvantage. So what happens? The average waiting time increases. Like for example, what is the waiting time for this particular process? Let us suppose 5 milliseconds. Huh? So it is 0 milliseconds time. It's immediately we allocate it. And after that he came, who the process P2. So how much time that P2 has to wait? 5 milliseconds. Why? Because he has to complete. P1 has to complete. So the average waiting time is 5 milliseconds. Now if we, 5 plus 0 by 2, so that is something 2.5 milliseconds. Now let us swap it up. Let us suppose that P2 came first, then we allocated P2 to the CPU. So what is the waiting time for the P2? 0. What about P1? P1 will wait for until this process is completing. So 2 milliseconds, so 2. So 2 plus 0 by 2. So how many milliseconds? 1 millisecond. So here the average, you can see that the average waiting time, if we are swapping it, the smallest one comes first is 1 millisecond, but if the longest one comes first, it is 2.5 milliseconds. That is the only disadvantage we do have. So the average waiting time for the algorithm will be too long. As we'll see that with the help of a small example so that you can understand very easily. Let's have a look. So I am taking example right now here. So I have taken 3 processes. So within our system, 3 processes have been created. Burst time, I think you people might have understood what you mean by burst time. We discussed about CPU burst by RDI burst. So this is the total time required for the process to complete its execution. Means whenever the CPU is allocated to the process P1, it takes 24 seconds or milliseconds or 24 units of time to complete its task. Next we have something called P2. So P2 takes around 3 milliseconds, or usually we consider this as milliseconds. If you don't know, or within the exam, he did not give this burst time in milliseconds, you can say 3 units of time. The basic thing is unit of time. As we discussed earlier, the scheduling criteria, so there we discussed that unit of time, isn't it? So that is what he's saying in this particular thing. Okay, same if you talk about your P3, so it will have something called 23 milliseconds of time. So all this, so P2 takes around 3 milliseconds, P3 takes 23 and P1 takes 24. And they have come up in the same process. Now we will take in the process like P1 came first, P2 then next, P3 later. And all the arriving time for all these processes is 0 milliseconds. The arriving time. When they have arrived means at 0 milliseconds. All of them has arrived at 0 milliseconds and they are ready to execute. Now let's see how it works. Now for this particular program or this problem, we need to actually prepare a Gantt chart. This is one of the famous charts what we have. If you can draw this perfectly, you can solve your problem very easily. We call it as Gantt chart. So let's see what do you mean by Gantt chart here. Okay, now as I told you, the processes are arriving. Let us, we are assuming that the processes are coming at of P1, P2 and P3. In this order, the processes have arrived at 0 milliseconds. So Gantt chart will look something like this. This is a Gantt chart. And remember, this one you people had to draw. This is for 2 marks in your question. It will be for 8 marks total the question. Among that 8 marks, 2 marks will be allocated to this particular Gantt chart. Now if you observe here, so this is nothing but a rectangle shape what we are doing it up. So initially we'll start from 0, because what did I say? The arrival, all these processes have arrived at what millisecond? 0 millisecond. So we are initially starting with 0. Since the process P1 came first, we have allocated to the CPU. This is a CPU timing, how much time it is taking. So P1 we have allocated. Now what is the total time for completion? It requires 24. So we have allocated almost 24 milliseconds time. So it started at 0 milliseconds till 24 milliseconds. After that, what happened? P2 came. Now since this process has completed execution, P2. So till 24 milliseconds are completing, P2, P3 have to wait. So once he is completing, we are allocating P2 to the CPU. So how much time he requires to complete that as 3 milliseconds. So here it requires 3 milliseconds. So 24 plus 3 is 27. Okay, just remember, then I'll tell you how to do it. 327. Next, P3 came. So after completion of P2, P3 comes into the picture. So we are allocating CPU to it. So P3 is 23. Okay. There's a small mistake here. This is not 23, 0. 3 milliseconds, sorry. It's 3 milliseconds. Okay. So here also it is taking 3 milliseconds. So 27 plus 3 is 30 milliseconds. Now from this diagram, I hope this is very clear. I'll explain it one more time. Way people have to draw the Gantt chart. So it will be coming in order. What is the sequence we have decided? P1, P2, P3. Okay, in the exam, they may ask you, or they may provide you the sequence. If they are not providing you the sequence, you can go based upon these parameters like 1, 2, 3. Based on that, you can take it up. So the first process came first. So we are starting from 0 milliseconds. Now the process P1 started executing in the CPU. How much time it requires is 24 milliseconds. So 24 milliseconds we have assigned. So this much gap. You can understand these gaps are most important. 24 is much more higher than 3 milliseconds and 3. So definitely you have to show more gap here. Then we have something called as P2. So P2 takes around how much? 3 milliseconds. So we are assigning here. So it takes around 3 milliseconds here. So when we are ending this, we need to write the total time. So 24 plus 3, 27. Then we have P3. P3 is also taking 3 milliseconds of time. So again, 3 milliseconds here. So 27 plus 3 is 30. So 30 milliseconds. Now from this diagram, we need to find out the waiting time. We need to find the average waiting time. And we need to find the average turnaround time. I think you people know about this waiting time and turnaround time. What is the waiting time here? Nothing but the time taken by the process to wait for accessing the CPU. That is what means he is ready to execute but is waiting for the CPU to be provided. That is what comes under waiting time. And what about turnaround time here? The total time taken by the process to complete the whole scenario, the whole task is what we call as turnaround time. Okay, is it clear? Now let's see how that waiting time works. So what is the waiting time for the process P1 here is nothing but, from the diagram, how you can understand is based upon the left part, whichever the block you are seeing, I am right now trying to find the waiting time for the process P1. So whatever the left side, the value we have, that is the waiting time of the process P1. So the waiting time for the process P1 is 0 milliseconds. Next, what is the waiting time for the process P2? Whatever is written onto the left of the tape, that is what the waiting time. So that is 24 milliseconds. Obviously, P1 takes 24 milliseconds to execute. Till then, he has to wait. That's why it is what we call it as waiting time. Now, what is the waiting time for the process P3? Exactly, it will be 27 milliseconds, the left side. So the waiting time, let's see how we got it. So the waiting time for the process is 0 milliseconds. I think you might have understood now the left part. The process P2 is 24 milliseconds, this one. And then we have something called as process P3. So it is having something called as 27 milliseconds. The left part will be representing that. Next, we have something called as average weight. So what is the average of this? I think you people are good in mathematics. So 0 plus waiting time for the process P1, waiting time for the process P2, waiting time for the process P3, 7 by 3. So how much you'll get is something like 7 plus 4, 10, 11, right? 2 to 4, 51 by 3. So that is something 21. So okay, it's around 17 milliseconds. What is the average waiting time we got here is 17 milliseconds. Let's have a look. So the average, yeah. So we got the exact answer here, 17 milliseconds. Very easy. Now we need to find out what is the waiting time for the process, total turnaround time. So in order to get the average turnaround time, we need to find the turnaround time for the process P1, P2 and P3. How we can find? It's very simple. So okay, let me explain it. Now turnaround time, what did we say? What do you mean by turnaround time? The total time taken by the process to complete the whole scenario. So how much time the process P1 has taken to complete here? That is what we call it as turnaround time. So how we can, with the help of the diagram, understand that is, whatever is written onto the left hand side, the border of that particular process is your turnaround time. So what is there here? 24. So the turnaround time for the process P1 is 24 milliseconds. Now if you go to the process, next process P2, what is the turnaround time? The right part, that is 27 milliseconds. Then what is the turnaround time for the process P3 is 30 milliseconds. So it took 30 milliseconds to complete the entire process P3. Okay. So let's see the diagram here so that you can understand clearly. So, okay. He is explaining that before, if the processes are arriving in a different format, then how we are exactly doing it up. Okay. So in that case, what he's saying, as I told you, the only disadvantage what we have, is the average time will be long enough, isn't it? So here, what we'll do is, we'll just try to swap the processes. Let us suppose initially, we are starting with P2, followed with P3 and P1. Initially, what we got? P1, P2, P3. So let us first do in this format so that you can understand. Then we'll go for the turnaround time. So if you observe here, if we are doing it in this format, how the Gantt chart will look like? Here, there is a lot of difference, isn't it? So what happened here? The low problem means the one which is having the lowest amount of time, we have brought it into the front. So what? So based on this, what is the waiting time for the process P2? You can understand, for the process P2 is 0 milliseconds, for the process P3 is 3 milliseconds, and the process P1 is 6 milliseconds. There is a lot of difference between this and this. So what is the average here? 0 plus 3 plus 6 by 3. So this is around 9 by 3. How many milliseconds? 3 milliseconds of time. There is a lot of difference, isn't it? So just because, you know what happens here? These two processes, even though they require very less time to complete the task, they have to wait. Why? There is a long process here. He has come up first, so we have allocated. And because of this, what happens? The average waiting time is 17 milliseconds. What about here? The average waiting time is 3. So that is the only drawback that we have in this particular algorithm. So I'll show you the with the help of the presentation here. So waiting time for the process P1 is 6 milliseconds. You can understand the left part. P2 is 0 milliseconds. P3 is 3 milliseconds. So definitely the average waiting time is 3 milliseconds. You can measure or you can compare the second 17 milliseconds and 3. There is a lot of difference, isn't it? So 3 milliseconds and 17. Lot of variation is there. That is the only drawback we do have. Next, we have something called a Conway effect. So this is what we call it as Conway effect. So what is not the mean by that is a long process is standing in front of us when compared to the short processes before. Okay, afterwards. So because of which what happens, these short processes has to suffer or they have to wait for longer in order to get it executed. So this is what comes under that. Okay, I think we did not represent that turnaround time here. I will explain that. Just a moment. Yeah. Fine, I'll take this example and I'll represent it. So let us take this. So here I'll explain you people. Okay, we have taken three different processes, isn't it here? We have P1, P2, and P3. So what is the time burst time we are taking? 24:33. What do you mean by burst time? The total time required to complete that particular process, the task for that particular process. Now, based on, we'll take the previous scenario only, P1, P2, P3 process. So we have allocated P1 first, started at 0 milliseconds. It has taken 24 milliseconds to complete the task. Next, we got P2. So P2 started executing it. So it has taken how many milliseconds? 3 milliseconds. So 24 plus 3 is 27. Then we got another process, P3. Okay, how much? 3 milliseconds. So that is 30. Now you might have understood the average waiting time, how to find. So waiting time for the process P1 is 0 milliseconds, P2 is 24, P3 is 27. So based on that, 0 plus 24 plus 27 by 3. So that is around something you got 17 milliseconds. Okay. Now I want just want to explain to you about turnaround time since I am going to present that. Now turnaround time, how we can do is the turnaround time for the process P1 is how much? So as I told you, you can consider the right part, that is this one. So the turnaround time for the process P1 is 24 milliseconds. Same way, the turnaround time for the process P2 is 27 milliseconds. What about the turnaround time for the process 3, P3 is 30 milliseconds. So just we want to find the average. Simply we, what we can do is 24 plus 27 plus 30 by 3. So this is something, what you will get approximately 24, right? So 24 plus 27, how much? 24 plus 27 plus 30. So that's around 81 divided by 3. So it's around 81 by 3. So that is equal to 27 milliseconds. So what is the average turnaround time for this particular execution of the processes is nothing but 27 milliseconds. And what is the average waiting time we have here is 17 milliseconds. Now if you take the previous scenario, I mean P2, P3, P1. So if you take the previous scenario here, what we have taken is P2. P3, it's not working properly. So let's take P2, P3, P1. So P2 take how much time? 3 milliseconds, 3 milliseconds, 24. So we have seen the Gantt chart, isn't it? So Gantt chart, how we have seen? So 0, P2 started, 3 milliseconds. Again, P3 came into picture. 6 milliseconds, 3 plus 3, then finally P1. So 24 plus 6 is 30. So waiting time, I think we have seen it already here. So what is the waiting time we got here is 3 milliseconds. Okay, so let's see the turnaround time. So the turnaround time for the process P1 is equal to how much? So P1 turnaround time, what we can see? 30. So that is right hand side, 30. What about process P2? We have right side here, 3. So it is 3. Then what about P3? So we have something called 6. Okay. So the average is 30 plus 3 plus 6 by 3. So that is around 39 by 3. So you can see there is a lot of difference here. 13 milliseconds. So even the average turnaround time, if we swap the lowest processes above, then the largest process, then there is a lot of difference even between the turnaround time and even for the waiting time. So here we have 13 milliseconds, whereas we got here 27 milliseconds. This is the way it exactly works. That is the only drawback we have with respect to your FCFS scheduling algorithm. Okay, is it clear with this? I hope it's clear. Next page, we'll take another page. Fine. Okay. Yeah. So I have this is clear. So what do you mean the convoy effect here is whenever the shortest process comes after the longest process, they have to wait for longer duration. That is what we call it as a convoy effect. Okay. So that is what all related to your SPFS shedding. Remember, it is a non-primitive. If it is a primitive, then we can try to prim this particular process in between. But since it is a non-primitive in nature, we cannot prim this particular process. We can only wait for that process to complete and come out. Until then, we cannot do anything to that particular process. That's why SPFS is called as non-primitive. Non-primitive in nature. Okay, so that is why it is called as non-primitive. The very next one overcomes this problem. That is what we have something called as shortest job first scheduling algorithm. So what this does? Well, since every process will have a burst time, now this particular algorithm, based upon the shortest burst time, whichever the process is having, that will be allocated to the CPU first. Later on, it will be executing. Okay. So every process here will have the length of its next CPU burst. What does that mean is nothing but, as we've seen in the previous example, we have written P1. It has the length of next CPU burst like 24 milliseconds. Then we have seen something called as P2. It has 3. So every process is having the CPU burst of how much? Now based upon this burst, which one is having the shortest job? Which one is the shortest job we have? That we will consider. Like here, if you take this example, P2 is having shortest, P3 is having shortest. Now here there is a confusion. Since both the processes have the same burst time, which one we need to consider? Well, in that case, we will be following FCFS order. Whenever two processes will have a same CPU burst time, then we will follow the first come, first service. So who came first? P2 came first. So we will consider this first and then this one. And then finally this one. This is the way this shortest job first scheduling algorithm works. Okay. So here, let me show you. Yeah. Now this SJF can be of two types. It can be something called as non-primitive. It can be primitive. If it is non-primitive, you can understand what do you mean by non-primitive. So whichever the shortest process is coming, we will allocate it to the CPU. It will perform its execution and then it will come out. Then the next process will be allocated. That is non-primitive. But if we consider that as a primitive, then what will happen? If new process is coming, okay? So like, you know, P1, P2, P3. Initially we had 3 processes. We gave 24, 3, 3, isn't it? Now when this particular process is executing P2, suddenly P4 came and the P4 is having a burst time of 1 millisecond. So in the meantime, this process is executing, let us suppose this particular process has executed for 1 millisecond. How much remaining time we have? It has to execute remaining 2 milliseconds. At that time, P4 came into picture. P4 is having, what is the burst time? 1 millisecond. So which one is having less, P2 or P4? Obviously, P4 is having 1 millisecond. So in primitive, what we will do is, we will stop this process from executing, we'll remove this from the CPU, and we allocate this process to the CPU. Why? He is having a lesser time when compared to the process P2. Once this P4 is completing it, then we will allocate P2. But P2 has already completed 1 millisecond of time. How much time it has to execute? 2 milliseconds. So it will execute that. Then it will come to P3. After P3, P1. This is what comes under primitive scheduling. So basically, if you are talking about non-primitive, it has another name called as CPU next burst. Okay, it has another name for that particular process. So basically, call that as what we call it as a shortest next CPU burst. If you people are using something called as non-primitive here, you are implementing something called non-primitively, we call it as shortest next CPU burst. Shortest next CPU burst. But in case if people are using primitive, then we call it with another name. That is what we have. We call that as something called shortest remaining time first. There is a difference between them. Shortest remaining. Shortest remaining time first. Okay, there is a lot of difference. So whenever we people are using non-primitive, then we are calling it as shortest next CPU burst. Means whichever process is having a shortest CPU burst, that will be allocated to the process. Like, you know, P1, P2, P3. So 24, 3, 3. So which one is having the shortest? So initially we allocated P2. Now we are left with P1, P2. Which one is having the shortest CPU burst? P3. So this is the next process which will be allocated to the CPU. That's why it is called as shortest next CPU burst. But whereas coming to primitive, we have something called shortest remaining time first. So whichever is having shortest time left, that will be allocated to the CPU. I'll explain that with example so that you can understand easily. So we are taking another example here where we have four different processes. Now all these processes will have a burst time 6, 8, 7, 3, and assume that all these processes are arriving. The arrival time for all these processes is 0 milliseconds. So at time 0 milliseconds, all these processes arrived into the ready queue. Okay. So what happened? All came simultaneously. So we did not have to focus on this particular thing, arrival time. We can skip it up since they all came at the same time. So the only focus will be on the burst time. Now among this burst time, since all the processes have come up at the same time, which one is having the shortest here? P4. So definitely in the Gantt chart, whatever you are going to use will start from a 0 milliseconds. So process P4, how much? 3. So we will allocate the shortest is that. So P4 will be allocated. So here we have 3 milliseconds. 0 plus 3, 3 milliseconds. Next, which one is the shortest? We do have P1. So we are allocating P1. So 6 plus 3 is 9. So 9 milliseconds. Then which one is shortest? P3. So we are allocating P3 here. So 9 plus 7 will be, I think it's 16, if I'm not wrong. 9, I'm told that it's 16. Okay. Then after that, we have P2. Finally, P2 we are allocating it. So it's around 8. So 8 plus 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 14, 20. So it's around 24 milliseconds. So this is what your gadget you people have received. Because all of them have arrived at time interval 0. That's the reason we got this particular diagram. Let me show you graphically so that you can understand. Yeah, this is the Gantt chart. I think this is what we got, 0, 3, 9, 16, 24. So P4 first we have assigned, then we have assigned P1, then P3, P2. This is the way. So what is the processing time? Okay, you know, based on that, we are going to calculate the average waiting time and average turnaround time. So what will be the average? Okay, first we'll find the waiting time. So what is the waiting time for the process P1? Left part, 3 milliseconds. So 3 milliseconds. What about the average waiting time for the process P2? It's 16 milliseconds. What about the P3 here? We do have 9 milliseconds. And finally, P4, 0. So what is the average waiting time we are having here? 6 plus 9 plus 3 plus 0. By how many processes we have? 4 processes. So it's around like, you know, 9, 10, 15, 25. 25 plus 3 is 28. By 4, it's around 7 milliseconds. So you should get 7 milliseconds. Yeah, here it is. Here people got it, 7 milliseconds. So average waiting time is 7 milliseconds. Then we have to discuss about the turnaround time, isn't it? So coming to the turnaround time, you know better how we had to take here. So let me first erase it so that you can understand. So the average turnaround time, okay, first we'll take the turnaround time. The turnaround time for the process P1 is, the right part what we have, 9 milliseconds. Whereas coming to the process P2, right hand side 24 milliseconds. Process P3, right hand side 16 milliseconds. You can see here. Then P3 milliseconds, here we got it. So what is the average we have? Same, 9 plus 24 plus 16 plus 3, but the total number of processes, 4. That is 13 milliseconds. So this is the way it exactly works. It's very easy, isn't it? Only thing, if you are able to draw this diagram perfectly, the remaining portion is very easy. You can easily get the waiting time and the average waiting time, turnaround time, and the average turnaround time. It becomes easy the way I have explained it. But only thing is, this diagram, you people have to draw it perfectly. And wherever the test, if you see here, 3 milliseconds is less than 6 milliseconds. You can see the gap here. How much gap we have given and how much. This is most important when you are drawing this. This is for 2 marks. This will be something for 2 marks and this will be for 2 marks. And remaining explanation, you'll be having 2 marks. Okay. So 2 plus 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So total 8 marks. This is the way they actually split you. So if you are drawing this Gantt chart wrong, then definitely you'll be losing the 2 marks. If you draw this perfectly, there is a mistake here. They'll provide you 1 mark. But here 2 marks will be allocated. 2 plus 1, 3, 5 marks you can easily gain it based on this. So please make sure whenever you're solving this problem, you're drawing the Gantt chart with a pen, pencil and a scale with neatness and as well as perfectly measuring it. Okay. So that is most important. So this is what we call it as non-primitive. Whatever the diagram you are seeing here, this is non-primitive. Anywhere we did not frame the process. Once the process is allocated to the CPU, we did not frame it. It is executing it, task, then it is coming out, then we are allocating the next process. Okay. Now we will see primitive, how primitive works. So coming to the primitive, as I told you, we call that as the shortest remaining time first algorithm. What we call that? Shortest remaining time first algorithm. Means, in this what happens is, whichever process is having the shortest remaining time, that will be allocated to the process. For example, we have two processes here, P1 and P2. Okay. So P1 is having 3 milliseconds, P2 is having 2 milliseconds. Now first what we did, we allocated P2. Okay, fine. We'll take this as 5 milliseconds. Now first we have allocated P1. P1 initially started from 0 millisecond and is doing it. 1 millisecond task is completed. Immediately P3 came. Okay, so P3 is having how much? 1 millisecond task. He requires only 1 millisecond to complete this task. But already CPU is occupied by process 1. And he has already completed 1 millisecond task. So what is the remaining portion, means time left for the P1? He has left with 2 milliseconds time. But at that time, this process which came up, P3, he is having only 1 millisecond. So which one is having less? Shortest? P3. Immediately we'll remove this process P1 from the CPU and we'll allocate that to P3. Okay, so this is the way it actually works. So when P3 completes its execution, then we'll remove that and we'll allocate P1. Because he is having 2 milliseconds and P2 is having 5. So we will be allocating that here, and based on that, this whole process works. I hope it is very clear. Let's see the example so that you can understand clearly. Yeah, now you people have to concentrate here. Since we got a new column here, something called as arrival time. So in the previous diagrams, in the previous sessions, whatever we discussed regarding your FCFS and SJF, we said the arrival time for all the processes is 0. But right now here, the arrival time is not 0. Initially at time 0 milliseconds, this process came. Only one process was there. But when it became 1 millisecond, then process P2 came. Then at the time 2 milliseconds, this process entered into the ready queue. At time 3 milliseconds, this process entered. Now this comes under primitive. Now this plays a very important role. Let's see how it plays a very important role. So let's see the diagram here. Look at here. Look at carefully. You can see there is a small changes here. Process P1 is executed multiple times here rather than a single time. Isn't it? So I will explain it so that you can understand. So at time 0, since we are starting the Gantt chart from 0, so at time 0, we have allocated process P1. What is the burst time he is having? He requires 6 milliseconds time. So when 1 millisecond time is completed, then process P2 came into picture. Okay. So when process P2 came here, how much task P1 has completed? 1 millisecond task is completed. What about the remaining? He has left with 5 milliseconds time to get it completed. Next, P2, when it came at 1 millisecond, what is the burst time is having? 8 milliseconds. Isn't it? P2 is having 8 milliseconds. So here, I think it's not 10 milliseconds. There's a small difference here. Just a minute. Okay, so here it's 849. Sorry. So it's a small mistake here. 849. Okay, this will come as 8 milliseconds. Just a minute. So here the burst time is given as in a different format. So it will be something like 8495. Okay, so any of the time is up, we'll stop here. I'll extend this in the next session. We may not be able to complete in this session this part. Okay, so I hope this is clear with this till here, whatever we have discussed. So non-primitive means we will not be having a time something called as arrival time, because we are assuming that all these processes are arriving. The arrival time for the process is 0 milliseconds. We are not considering that, okay? So in the next one, what we will see is we'll just shuffle the numbers and we'll provide the time interval and then we'll try to solve it. That requires a little time, around some 5 to 10 minutes, but since it's 11:40, we can't cover it up. So we'll see that in the next class. Still here, I think it's very clear. So previous, we discussed about 2 things here, something called FCFS, that's very easy. And next is SGF. So in SGF, we have something called as non-primitive and primitive. So whatever the diagram you're seeing here or whatever we have solved it here, that is purely primitive in, I mean, non-primitive in nature. So how primitive works, we will see it. And okay, fine. So we'll see the remaining portion in the next class.